So anyway, hi, we're gonna talk about how containers, not magic, not gonna fix your, you know, or corporate culture. My name is Bridget Kromhout. I came about a little over, 13,000 kilometers. I think that's a thing. I had to look that up, but I'm not positive what kilometers are. But I came about that far to get here from Minneapolis, Minnesota. If you're not super familiar with US geography, some of you are, but if you're not super familiar with it, Minnesota's in the middle, in the north, right near Canada, by a bunch of big lakes. We have 1 month out of the year, July, where it's never been known to snow. It's possible to snow the rest of the time. More on that later. I work at Pivotal, doing tech advocacy for the open source cloud for the open source cloud foundry platform. I podcast at arresteddevops.com with a couple of fantastic folks, and I am part of the shadowy global cabal that operates DevOps days everywhere. So if some of you know AJ, who runs the one here in Bangalore, where we collaborate on these things. Okay, a little bit more about how I got to here. I spent 1999 until August on call for production infrastructure. I was not sad to delete the PagerDuty app from my phone. And when you spend that long in ops, you get used to having terrible sleep. That sleep graph from back when I was actually trying to track these things was, I think, HBase was having a lot of problems. But as it turns out, trading that for a lot of conference talking and traveling does not improve your sleep. There's just more jet lag. So, and back to containers. So this is not Photoshopped, except for, I did add the word DevOps. Like, that shipping container didn't come with a bunch of DevOps in it. But this is actually a picture I took in Minneapolis, where it's apparently like cloudy with a chance of DevOps at all times, because we've got containers, we've got silos, we've got some clouds there, all the stuff that you expect. And I confused my partner Joe by stopping while we were biking on our way to our community garden and taking this picture, because I thought this kind of typifies all of the things that people think that they need to worry about or think that they need to do. And I gotta say, I have actually spent a bunch of time with containers in production. My last gig was running Docker in production for a year. So I have actually done that. It was fantastic. It was delightful. It did not actually solve all our problems, as it turns out. I know, right? I was surprised too. When I joined, I was like, these people have been running Docker in production since October 2013, back when the main thing on Docker's website was like, under no circumstances should you run this in production. And they were like, YOLO, and started running it. And so when I joined in summer of 2014, I was like, hey, this is gonna be fantastic, because you can never have any problems whatsoever if you're Dockering all the Dockers, right? Well, as it turns out, I found out that I was working at a company that was run entirely by humans. I know, and staffed entirely by humans, which meant that even if we had great technology, it didn't actually make everything better. We were trying to win at buzzword bingo, so we were, because we started in 2009 at this streaming video service, which, by the way, was kind of like Netflix, if Netflix were mostly K-dramas and, much smaller and ran Docker in production, so maybe not exactly like Netflix, but we started in 2009, which meant that because we were a Python shop, we were obviously using Django. And by early 2014, we were rewriting things in Go because that was the style at the time. Lots of tech fashion stuff that goes on there. But what we learned in trying to break things out into a whole bunch of microservices is that microservices make everything better too, right? Yes, they help certain problem sets, but they're not gonna magically make everything better either. Because if you look at all of these tech trends, and I thought that this wouldn't work, this slide wouldn't work here, then I went and visited two different tech companies the last couple of days, and both times at lunch we had pizza. So I was like, okay. Of course they were smaller pizzas, and then I'm thinking, two pizza team is a really confusing phrase, because how big are the pizzas? And how hungry are the people? I feel like this does not necessarily work in all cases. But Amazon has this whole two pizza team thing where you should have really small teams that own an entire service end to end. Spotify has their squads. There's a lot of tech trends like that. And I say, okay, that kind of stuff works to a point, but you don't necessarily need two pizza teams to do microservices, right? Because your microservices are going to increase your complexity. They're gonna make it a little bit more depending on what your telemetry looks like, depending on how you have things, you know, in terms of visibility, microservices might make it a little bit more difficult to solve some problems until you've got your monitoring telling you which of the end microservices these problems are coming out of. So the communication between the groups that are running in the different microservices still matters a lot, even if the groups are small enough to be fed by, you know, pizza of arbitrary size. Is that like rodent of unusual size? I don't know. That would be like distressing. But when you look at Conway's law, and Conway's law, by the way, if you're not familiar with it, is paraphrased here. In the paper in which Mel Conway originally wrote it, which was published in 1968, called How Committees Invent, he got to the good stuff. He got to this right near the end of the paper. I don't know how anyone got that far in the paper. Like, I wouldn't read something called How Committees Invent and be like, this is exciting. Let's find something seminal and important in here. But apparently it was. And this rephrasing of it comes from his website now. Apparently he's still alive and has a website. And no real way to contact him on it, so I guess we can't get him to come speak at conferences. I don't know. But I think the most important word in Conway's law is communication. Because a lot of people look at Conway's law and they think, oh, if the structure of our organization is going to dictate the structure of our software, that means that if we want to have microservices, we have to break up into these small cross-functional teams. And I think, yeah, well, maybe. I mean, kind of like Nicole was saying when I asked her, you know, a possibly troublesome question after her wonderful keynote this morning, the answer is usually it depends. Because if you have a lot of separate teams, or maybe even teams who work across continents, but they have good communication between the teams, you might be fine. You might be better than a bunch of cross-functional teams that don't actually communicate or talk to one another. And if they have clean APIs between the teams, and that's kind of this, you know, like Amazon-esque ideal, but then if there's breaking changes and, you know, unversion changes to the APIs that the other teams are depending on, you've made your problems worse. It's like technology helps us solve those problems a lot, but it does not actually, it doesn't provide a panacea that's going to, you know, suffice for absolutely every use case. And by the way, like speaking of, you know, tech trends, tech fashion, whatever, like I don't know about you, but I'm really excited for what's gonna be, 2019 is the year we're gonna all get really excited about inodes. And I say this with all, you know, I say this with great love, very tongue in cheek, but like the fact that I'm even putting the word container in a talk title and then people are showing up to hear about it when they don't really know what they're gonna talk about. Spoiler alert, there's some cat pictures in here, right? The word, putting, like, you know, some of these hot tech buzzwords in talk titles does get people to show up and gets people interested, but the tech in and of itself is not what's going to solve all of these problems for us. It's basically, you know, where I'm going with that. And I think, like, if we look at this, and, I don't know, I feel like syscalls is going to just get ignored. We're going to go right from threads to inodes, I'm pretty sure. But if we look at the hype cycle, this is a Gartner hype cycle, and we think about like how people make tech decisions. I'm pretty sure no one here makes their tech decisions by like running a Markov bot against the front page of Hacker News. I mean, maybe. Like, I'm pretty sure I've seen some organizations that have. Probably no one here. But like, people who are trying to make tech decisions, like I work at a vendor now for the first time in my career. I go in and I talk to other companies, and I hear a lot of people say, who like us is having success doing this? People want to see a reference customer in their industry, in their vertical, you know, maybe with their kind of market cap, maybe even in their country, who's having success with this particular technology. And I think that's very narrow and segmented, but it's also a very human thing to want to look at people who have some sort of commonality with you and see what kind of success they're having trying to make these choices. And I think the reason is because there's a lot of choices out there. There's a lot of complexity out there. And you can shortcut some of the decision making by saying, well, other people like me with along whatever axis have had success doing it. So maybe I'll have success too. And that works to a point, but then when you try to have that intersect with the hype cycle, you're like, I think I want to use containers, but nobody like me is using containers successfully in production yet. And then everybody starts looking at analyst reports, and it's like, again, this is where we're at an Agile conference, so I think I feel safe in saying that everybody here probably agrees that taking small steps and iterating and trying things is a lot more successful than waiting around until someone else who's exactly like you has finished an end-to-end successful story. It's like, you know as well as I do that that's not the best way for you to get ahead in the market. So, and at the same time, like, we are obviously at a point of great change. Like, we're obviously at a point of, you know, just like, you know, the idea of like when virtualization first started happening, Like the fact that we have, you know, containerization is something that is a big deal to a lot of people right now, is different than it was before. Like we are at a time where things are changing significantly, changing pretty quickly. This is a quote from a science fiction TV show from the 90s that I'm sure some people remember, but there's this very profound line that a character who otherwise is rather forgettable says, where he says, "Nothing's the same anymore." And I'm like, yep, you can apply that in so many cases, especially in tech right now. At the same time, again, I go in and I talk to a lot of these companies, and they're very excited about their greenfield projects, and they want to put them on Cloud Foundry, our platform, and they kind of say sheepishly, and then we have all this legacy stuff, as if it's a bad thing. Like, as if, you know, the fact that there are these startups coming, nipping at their heels, who are going to disrupt everything, who are going to cause trouble, who don't have all that legacy to worry about, and just have a greenfield app to deploy, as if those people have the significant advantage that the companies that have been established don't have. And what I would say to that is, well, again, back to Nicole's point, it depends, because if that legacy data, that legacy system didn't matter, you'd just turn it off. Like, obviously, there's something really important there. Probably your customers, your revenue stream. Like, there's usually a reason that the legacy system is important enough for you to be working on trying to migrate it. Now, the reality is that sometimes if you hang on to a legacy system long enough, you're probably going to have to do some massive, like, rewriting, replatforming. I went to the Science Museum here, actually, and I was super excited to see in the museum an IBM 1401. The reason I was super excited is because I don't know if anyone here happens to recognize it, but the font that I'm using here is a font that is based, it was made by Jeff Kellum, and it was based on the font that was produced on the IBM 1403. So it's like, yeah, that's kind of awesome. I had never seen an IBM 1403, which is the printer right there. I had never seen it in person. So, because I guess they have one at the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, and I've always been upstairs at the DevOps Days events and need to go down and actually see the machine. But the thing that I thought was really interesting about this is that they had a sign saying that this was, you know, donated to the museum from the government, and it was in use until 1989, and it was producing money orders for, like, the post office or something. And I thought, you know what? They kept that system until it was no longer useful. Like, and possibly longer than it was, you know, useful or whatever, but I bet you anything, when they first started using this, you know, a really long time ago, it was probably useful for a lot of things, including perhaps money orders, but probably not limited to money orders. And I would say there was probably a very smart pattern here where one piece of functionality at a time was migrated off of this mainframe until finally it was able to be retired and shipped to the museum. And that's actually, when you're trying to move to microservices, that's, and you know, you can't necessarily take your entire legacy application off of the 1401, shove it into a container and be like, we're done, hooray. It's like, that's probably not gonna work super well. So there is gonna be a certain amount of redesign, refactoring, figuring out which pieces of the application you can rewrite, and then maybe have something proxy back to the old data store, until you've, you know, kind of that strangler pattern, which sounds sort of murderous and terrible, but I guess it's related to like vines or whatever, and until it's possible to actually move away from the old. But trying to do this, you know, kind of second system syndrome, as Astrid Atkinson at Google called it in her keynote at QCon, doesn't really make a ton of sense. Like this, we've built an entirely new perfect thing. 2 years later, we're gonna cut over to it. Let's hope it's ready. It's like, even though Agile obviously started in software development, as an IT ops person, I can tell you, like, we have to think about this, you know, iterative change in operations too. And if we don't, I gotta tell you this, by the way, I took this picture, I think it was April in Minnesota, there was still snow. Not a lot of snow, but there was still snow. And that sad snowman is definitely not long for this world. And it reminds me of this Deming quote where he says that, I mean, you don't have to change. Like, it's not necessary to change. However, survival is not mandatory. So like, at some point, you need to make the decision to go ahead and change. And deciding what the right path for change is for you and exactly how to implement it and which things need to go first is a completely localized decision. And that's kind of one of those things where, you know, people will sometimes pay consultants to come in and tell them exactly how to do this. And it's like, that's cool, but get somebody like, you know, ThoughtWorks or Pivotal or whomever to come in and help you with your agile IT transformation. There's a whole bunch of great sponsors here that'll come in and help you with that transformation. But you're gonna have to make the decisions yourself about what's right for you, because nobody else is gonna understand your use case as well as you are. And you definitely should beware of anyone who tries to sell you DevOps in a box. So like, just like that shipping container earlier definitely didn't contain 200 units of DevOps, there are not, you know, a couple of dozen delicious DevOps chocolates in this box. Well, actually there are, but this was at DevOps Days Belgium in Ghent in 2014. Our badges were a certificate of DevOps, and they gave us DevOps chocolate. And which is just kind of the tongue-in-cheek, well, I mean, yes, you can get DevOps in a box. It will be delicious. It's still not going to dev any of your ops. Like, it's not going to actually make the transformative changes you need to make in your organization. That's a question of your internal will and the leadership coming from your organization. Like, for example, Allstate Insurance has a very forward-thinking CTO, Andy Zitney, who spoke at CloudFounder Summit last year and was talking about how when Allstate decided that they wanted to make changes, they had leadership, you know, at the top saying, this is important, this is something we're gonna prioritize. And they also had people, you know, throughout the ranks saying, yes, we wanna do this. Like, you do need both. But it's not something that you can just buy. And these tweets entertain me a lot because, like, if we consider that DevOps is empathy, then, I mean, are we selling enterprise empathy automation tools? I mean, like, probably not. So it's not that it's not necessarily a drop-in one-to-one replacement, but it does make us think a little about if we're using this concept of DevOps to move more effectively. Oh, and we also have from Patrick Dubois, who started the first DevOps Days. It was actually an Agile conference. I don't know if you've heard this story. Stop me if you've heard this one before. I mean, actually, don't stop me. There's video. You know, other people who haven't heard it before, who aren't in this room with us, might hear this later. But in 2008, at the Agile conference, one of the Agile conferences, Andrew Clay Schaefer put up a birds of a feather session that he wanted to have about Agile systems administration. And then he thought, nobody's going to come to this. And so he didn't show up at his own birds of a feather session. One person showed up. It was Patrick Dubois, who had to go track Andrew down later and talk to him because Andrew wasn't at his own session. And their discussion eventually led to Patrick going back to Belgium and starting the first DevOps Days in Ghent in 2009. And when we asked him about, okay, so if it came out of Agile, like, why is it called DevOps Days? He said, Agile Systems Administration was too long for a conference name. I'm like, okay, I can see that would be a pretty long hashtag. That would be a little bit harder to fit on a badge than even any of this stuff. So I can see that point. But, like, this idea of moving towards thinking of DevOps as, you know, not just tooling, but also this human cooperation between the different parts of the business is not just touchy-feely stuff. As Nicole was saying this morning, there's data that shows that this makes us more effective. It's like we're gonna be more successful if we're focusing on this team stuff. There's an effective DevOps book that's coming out soon. It's in pre-release from O'Reilly right now that's very much worth reading. I was fortunate enough to be an early reader for it. Jennifer Davis and Catherine Daniels are writing this. And one of the things Jen Davis said in a blog post for SysAdvent this year just focused on, we don't want tooling that makes it impossible for the humans to understand what's happening. At the same point, you know, like we just heard, we don't want to have tooling that requires human intervention, you know, unnecessary gating, where we don't actually want to stop the process. We don't want human intervention. But choosing and creating tooling that's comprehensible to the humans involved in the process is super important. And, like, the idea of, you know, the secret herb bunker, like, please do not touch, the separation you can get between dev and ops where, you know, oh, okay, ops stuff is checked in, but it's in a private repo, and, like, the devs can't have access to that, like, that's an anti-pattern, because that's not going to make it easier to have transparency and visibility throughout the organization as to what's actually going on. A couple of startups ago, I worked somewhere where we had, you know, graphs, we had graphs on, you know, coming out of graphite, like, you know, displayed on TVs that showed things about, like, you know, things hitting our API endpoints and whatnot. And one time, a customer success person came in the morning before me. I mostly rolled in, like, just in time for stand-up. But she came in, she saw on the TVs that our normal pattern had turned to whoop, and everything was flat. And she looked at that, and she could tell from which graph it was that that was clearly one of our major customers. And we were no longer, there was no way we were still appearing on their website if that was the traffic pattern coming off of their site. Because we were the dreaded third-party cookie, ad tech, ooh. I used to be evil. I might still be evil, because I report up through marketing now. But what she found was that when she went and looked at the customer's site, indeed, our widget was missing. She was able to diagnose that, talk to the customer. They had had a botched deploy that had accidentally taken our stuff off the site early in the morning hours. And she had it fixed and the graph back up to normal, like before I even came into work. It was fantastic. And like when you have, you know, visibility radiating out to the rest of the organization, and you aren't keeping all the information into the, you know, the ops priesthood, like you can have much better success for everyone. And this idea of like choosing both, you know, your monitoring, your tooling, your architectural patterns, and just making the right thing, making the thing you want everyone to do, the easy thing, I think is really profound. Like that's the direction we're trying to go. And we have, shall I say, we have the technology. Like we can, with technology, gate people towards the behaviors that are gonna be the best for everyone. Things like exactly which Git workflow you choose. Like, hey, if you choose a Git workflow that is, you know, kind of anti-continuous integration, let alone continuous deployment, that is gonna cause problems for you. So I also think that we have to consider the complexity in the systems that we're building and the systems that we're, you know, making visible to the consumers, maybe inside our company, of the stuff that we're automating. Like for example, if you're a platform team and you're making services available to other teams inside the org, like if those services are such that they are, you have very leaky abstractions and they have to comprehend absolutely every single bit of complexity in your system, and yes, I'm looking at you, storage system in Azure, so confusing. If you've tried to use EBS and then you've tried to use the storage in Azure and compared them, like you'll know what I'm talking about. It's like, why are you exposing these particular limitations and abstractions to the end user? Like if you can have really clean APIs that expose, you know, leak as few abstractions as possible, you know, when you're cooperating between your teams and your organization, it's like way more helpful. And containers are, back to containers, they were in the title, so I gotta talk about them from time to time. Containers, I think, are a really useful boundary object. Because if, for example, some developers have dependencies and that they really care about, and they can package those up and build the container through their CI system, there isn't gonna be any of that Docker build, Docker push from somebody's laptop, and you're like, the Docker file has add a bunch of stuff. Wonder where that is. Is it checked in? So like, obviously any images that you're gonna actually run in production are being generated by your CI pipeline. But for people who are very concerned about moving to something more modern than what they have, because maybe what they have now, they at least know that like they've got their version of Java and their dependencies under control. And then they realize that, hey, if I move to something that's more containerized, whether the containers are being generated inside the platform or out, like via a build pack or via a Docker image, like that stuff, those are implementation details. But if people are gonna move to a more containerized runtime, the dependencies that are necessary for an application go with the application. And the application developers don't have to worry about whether or not somebody's gonna upgrade the underlying OS and render their, you know, super essential what's it, like inoperable. So I think that's kind of valuable.
Yeah, this, if any of you are from Portland, this picture is from the carpet replacement at the airport. Apparently some people were very, I'm not from Portland, but I visited there when they're in the middle of replacing the airport carpet. Apparently I think the one closer to me is the old carpet and the one further away is the new one, and people were very, very concerned about slash attached to the old airport carpet. I'm like, I don't even know. But I kind of had this visual in my mind of like, you know, clean distinction between worrying about the concerns of the underlying OS and worrying about like the concerns of your specific application. Because we don't want the classic wall of confusion, right? Like you've seen these a million times. I feel like, you know, you could change, you could replace the I want change and I want stability with like YOLO and nope. I mean, this is the classic tension between development and operations that I think we don't need to have, because we have decent tooling now to make it unnecessary to have all of the manual friction and handoffs that cause a lot of this tension. And because Nicole referenced it this morning, I had taken the slide out and then I decided to, you know, drop it back in because she mentioned it this morning. So pop quiz, does anyone actually know when this was said? I know Nicole does, but does anybody else know when this, you know, in the last week there were 67 deploys of 496 changes by 18 people? Jez knows. Do you actually know or are you guessing? All right, let's hear it. Yes, do you know when? Almost, you're right. This was from a Flickr dev blog in 2008. It was quoted in the talk at Velocity
the 10 deploys a day at Flickr talk of velocity that Nicole talked about in her keynote this morning. And the reason that I want to bring this one up is because so many of us today are not at a place where we can say this. And if the people are looking around in the room and saying, oh, no, I deploy 10 times a minute. And you're like, okay, you do, but a lot of large organizations I talk to do not. And we have to think to ourselves, why could Flickr do this in 2008 if a lot of us can't do it today? And yeah, the tooling is better now for a lot of this, but they were operating with the tools that they had in 2008 and they could do it. So I think that's pretty good evidence that tools are not the only part of this that matter. Having the culture of cooperation between dev and ops and cooperation across the entire organization, like, it seems pretty clear that at least in this particular case, that made a big difference for them. And I think when we're talking about cooperation between organizations and, you know, across teams, I think it's really important to remember, especially since I'm standing here in Bangalore, still sort of jet-lagged, talking to folks, that there's CAP theorem, which some of you probably are familiar with. This it's a concept out of distributed systems, and it's basically when we are looking at it, say, a distributed system, maybe it's a distributed data store or whatever, you can have consistency, availability, partition tolerance, like pick two. You can't have all three at a given time. And I think it's really interesting that Eric Brewer, who came up with this concept, went back, he revisited it like 12 years later, wrote an interesting article that I think is on InfoQ or something somewhere, where he talked about how for a partition, what you really are saying is, well, it's a time bound, right? I mean, like, okay, you're partitioned, but until how long? It's really a question of how long you're going to wait for that partition to come back together before you're gonna say, all right, we're just operating in split brain. And we're trying to design a lot of our distributed systems today such that it's possible to operate in a state of continuous partial failure, as they like to call it, because realistically, whether you're in public, private, cloud, whatever, you're gonna be operating in a state of continuous partial failure pretty much all the time. I mean, oh, come on, that was the cue for the projector to go out. Why is the power still on? But seriously, looking at this and thinking about a partition as being, you know, time-bounded just immediately makes me think of, yeah, like, here in Bangalore, if you're cooperating with people in Minneapolis, are you gonna wait 10 and a half hours every day before you make any decision? Like, I'm gonna go with no. I don't know, shout it out. Yes, no, you wanna wait 10 and a half hours? No, absolutely not. I got to tour Target's Agile Dojo on Wednesday, and it was Anuj, who's actually sitting right here, and invited me to come and see it. And what I was impressed by was that it had many similarities to the Target Agile Dojo in Minneapolis, but it was also being run completely independently. There were no callbacks to, and then when Minneapolis does this, then we do that. And I'm like, excellent, because just like if you look at something like Consul from HashiCorp, the nodes all talk to each other via a gossip protocol. There's no like waiting for the, you know, the lead node to kind of give it kind of some kind of information. And it's like you can't have this, just like in our distributed systems, we don't design them to be blocking on some sort of central source of truth at all times. And we can't do that with our human interactions either. So I think that these are the kind of patterns that, again, using a lot of the modern, or perhaps not so modern, I mean, containers have been around since the 70s at least, but using a lot of the tooling that we have today, we can enhance the kind of cultural practices that make us more effective. I also think that there's no substitute for actually talking to people. And yes, when Naresh asked this morning, like, what's your favorite part of a conference? I said, hallway track, because like, I like to come to conferences and hear what other people are saying, get to know other people, because hey, you get 140 character snippets on Twitter here and there, maybe from time to time you're gonna read a blog post, but the real-time high bandwidth interactions of in-person communication, definitely, you know, the value of that definitely can't be denied. And I'm a remote employee, I've been one for a couple years now, and I enjoy that a lot, but the face time that you get to spend with people is also super valuable. So, that said, like, especially for people who are remote employees or collaborating across teams, we do a lot of pair programming at Pivotal, which is fantastic. We also do pair ops work, which I find unusual but interesting. And I just came back from a 2-week rotation with our cloud ops team that runs our hosted Pivotal web services, where I got to work on that team for 2 weeks, which was pretty great. And one of the things that we did was, you know, day to day when we're swapping pairs, people would orally pass on context.
you know, one person would stay with the problem. And, you know, the other person would go work on something else. And then the person with context would, like, stay in the problem, and another pair would swap in. And that works for, you know, like, moving forward with high velocity. There can't deny that pair programming is very useful for that. And it's, at the same time, like, you have to still write things down, because at some point someone's going to go on vacation or go to a conference on the other side of the planet and not be available to you for real-time querying, whether it's because they got a promotion or another job or whatever. So, on the other hand, I'm not a huge fan of documentation and runbooks and giant checklists. And the reason I'm not a huge fan of those is because I feel like they get outdated the second you make them. But at the same time, saying, well, this code is self-documenting also doesn't necessarily solve the problem. Because what I end up doing is looking at the code that I wrote like 6 months later and saying, past you, what were you thinking? Like, why does this code commit just tell me what this code does? That is not helpful. I can read the code. I know what the code does. I don't know why. So I think that the kind of documentation that's actually useful is just a detailed commit at the moment that you make that decision and commit it that says why you did this, as opposed to the myriad other things you could have done. Because, I mean, of course, like, you can add more information than that, but to me, that's like the minimum viable. If we're going to be all agile and say, like, MVP, like, the minimum viable commit should say why this is going in. Because that way people can, they don't need to go try to consult a giant checklist or a giant, you know, design document that's probably wrong to figure out why that particular decision was made. So a little bit more about DevOps' culture. So I feel like at one point I tweeted this in August 2014. I was very, set on this DevOps' culture. It's only culture. It's not tools. Tools are definitely not part of DevOps. And when I tweeted this, Andrew Clayshaver answered me and said, everyone is selling, in just kind of his, like, you know, mysterious Oracle of Delphi sort of way. And what I think is actually true here, like, is that DevOps is culture, but the tools enable the culture. So the tooling and the practices, all the stuff that we're doing to make, you know, our cooperation possible is how we practice DevOps together. Which means that we have a lot of choices that we need to make to try to figure out how to do this. I'm like, okay, that's great. Those are a lot of ideas. But, like, how should we actually do this? Like, is there a 14-point, you know, DevOps thing? I'm like, well, while there are people like, say, Nicole and Jez, who will definitely help you evaluate whether or not you're devving all your ops and if you're going to be DevOpsing at the velocity and with the accuracy that's right for you, like, the answer is it really depends. It depends on where your organization is now, what you're trying to accomplish. Like, this, it's always a very individualized and self-evaluation that you go through is a lot more valuable than trying to go and get certified by someone else. Because, like, again, I mean, honestly, if somebody's going to give you a certificate of DevOps, like, they're saying, you successfully graduated from kindergarten. Like, you're not eating crayons and you're sharing with other children. It's like, okay, that's fantastic. Like, you learned to share, that's great. But, I mean, I don't think that that's a useful thing to say somebody is certified in. But the kind of things that I think it's useful to measure is, like, say you're trying to evaluate your progress, like, how well you are actually doing at improving your culture. For example, here, like, we have these squash. I mentioned the community garden earlier, that all those containers and silos are on the way to. So we have these squash, and they're absolutely enormous, way bigger than those tomatoes. So that means we did a great job of growing squash, right? Well, not exactly, because those are patty pan squash, and they're supposed to be smaller than my fist. So we actually neglected them way too long, and when we tried to eat them, they were terrible. So if your only measure of progress is, like, the number of people working on this, and how high the budget is, and the lines of code produced, I mean, there's so many ways you can measure progress that are probably not actually useful. And so looking at the actual value achieved, like, what are the actual results that we've gotten for our organization that are useful, as opposed to looking at, you know, I mean, I like monitoring, I like metrics. Sorry to the statisticians in the room, but you all know the lies, damned lies, and the stats coming out of your monitoring system, right? It's like, it's possible to make your measurements look like anything you want them to, and so it's a lot more valuable to at least focus on what has improved in our organization, in our culture, like, and for our business. Another thing that I wanna warn people off from is the idea of saying we want to implement a lot of changes, but we also want to keep our old processes. We want to keep our release management, and we want to keep our ITIL, and we want to keep our fill in the blank. Okay, so a lot of process is usually in place because something went wrong in the past. Like, for example, this is from Amsterdam, and I'm a quarter Dutch, so I can say, like, I don't understand those Dutch people, man. Because, like, I was in Amsterdam, and this sticker is in every bathroom of the hotel that Velocity in Amsterdam was in last year. And a lot of people started tweeting the picture, which is why I didn't go and visit every bathroom, but, like, a lot of people started tweeting the picture, which is why I realized that this wasn't just in our bathroom, this isn't apparently in every bathroom. And what it says there, if you can't read it, is, we kindly request you to take your shower in the bathtub. And I'm thinking, what happened at this hotel enough times that they thought it was important enough that they printed a sticker and put it in every bathtub? And I'm thinking, like, there's so many places where, I mean, I worked someplace that had really ITIL-heavy process, and we had a 42-page change management process, and it would go to the change control review board, and they would decide whether or not that change could go to production. And unless something was horribly wrong, at which point we could just put things in production immediately. It's shocking. I'm pretty sure the statute of limitations expired on that job, because that was, like, you know, over a decade ago. So I'll just tell you, it's shocking how many emergencies we had. Because pretty much every time I wanted to make a change, I only had to fill out, like, the 3-page emergency form and then just do it. And the thing is, if a change being made in that kind of way is okay when everything is on the line, when everything is broken, when everything is down, and when you're, you know, like we were hearing earlier, it's 3 a.m. and somebody is trying to make that decision then. If your fast track hotfix process is okay then, it's probably okay in the light of day when everybody is there. Like, but a lot of organizations that are trying to change do kind of fall into that trap of, but we still want to keep, and then the giant heavyweight processes. It's like, okay, that's not actually going to make things better. That's actually going to make things worse. And I think another thing that people run into some trouble with is, I warned you, there are cat pictures. This is our cat, Nimoy, affectionately known as Attack Kitten. He spends a lot of time attacking, well, everything, but lately mostly he's been attacking laptops, fingers, Apple-branded cables. I guess they're more delicious than any other cable. And also learning a lot about everything that you see on that laptop just by osmosis from the stickers. I'm pretty sure he's become an expert at Docker by this point, just by proximity. But I think staying on top of all of this stuff that we need to learn, that we need to know about, all of the computering stuff, is actually kind of tough. And then you're thinking, like, okay, I was told I need to Docker all the Dockers. I'm definitely doing that. And now, wait, I also have to have some platform or orchestration or scheduling. Like, I need to also do all those things. I just changed this other thing, or I was just looking into changing this other thing, or I was just trying to get some configuration management, and now you're telling me I also need some containers? And I feel like trying to stay on top of every change and implement every change instantly is a fool's game. Like, that's not actually what a successful organization is going to do. This is back to the, you know, technology trend stuff. It's like, you have to pick the stuff that's going to make you more effective, not the stuff that everyone else is saying is super. Because if we're trying to make a good culture for our employees, a culture where they get to try and new things and learn is great. A culture where they feel like they're under constant pressure and they can never catch up is horrific. So, like, we don't want to do that to people. And I think when we were talking about that wall of confusion earlier, the little brick wall that was so low you could throw things over is not what it really looks like, right? Like, the wall of confusion between teams is more like something like this. I took this picture standing on a frozen lake in Minnesota. And so this is my partner Joe just standing right there. And I'm way out on the lake, and that all that white stuff is lake. And yes, that is what it looks like a fair amount of the time. And imagining trying to see past that wall, trying to climb that wall. I mean, I assume there's probably, like, some White Walkers or something terrible beyond that wall. You know, like, this is not the kind of environment that we want to have people in when they're trying to figure out what to do. Like, when people are trying to be successful and make changes in their organization, but when I go into organizations where we have to go and have separate meetings because the head of application development and the head of IT infrastructure are not going to come to the same meeting, I'm like, you probably shouldn't buy anything from us. Like, sorry, salespeople, cover your ears, but, like, selling you any kind of tooling is not going to help, because you need to first get your culture to a place where people are willing to cooperate and get past, you know, just kind of blankly staring at something like this to, hey, like, this wall doesn't actually have to be this way. you can just walk a little bit further down and you can see under it and through it and just go around. Like, yeah, you may not be able to tear down every silo, you know, the whole DevOps trend of like, get rid of those silos. And you're like, again, we can't do we have thousands of people. We can't do a giant reorganization into 5-person squads and like have that be our company. That's not realistic for us. You don't necessarily have to do that. Why tear it down? Just walk around it. You can give yourself permission to ignore the rules that don't make sense for what you're trying to do today. And like that is, in a nutshell, that's like the DevOps journey. Like, and I think, and I took this picture back in 2009, actually, in South Africa. And I recently gave this talk at Cape Town, and someone said, I've taken a picture of that tree. And I thought, wow, okay, that's kind of random. It's like the exact same stretch of road. They drive on the left side of the road there as well. I tried to drive, I panicked, I couldn't. I had to leave all the driving to my brother. And I gotta say though, this was a fairly typical road on that particular drive on the garden route in South Africa. Pretty much every road I've been on here is the exact opposite. So I must commend absolutely everyone here who is brave enough to drive a car on the left side of the road with that many cars on the road, because it's, I'm gonna say everyone here is a better driver than almost anyone I've ever met. So, but, because it's a little bit terrifying as a passenger. But imagine, if you will, that there was a road that was not entirely full of honking auto rickshaws, and imagine that the journey itself was, you know, a very interesting part, not just the destination, but the journey itself was part of what you actually were trying to do. And I feel like trying to say, oh, we have fixed everything ever, and now we are DevOps, it's like, it's ridiculous, right? Because we're all on this continuum, we're all on this journey, we're all progressing towards the goal of having improved. But that doesn't mean that you're going to get there and be done. Like, that's not actually how it works. And I think the places that, you know, the places I've worked and the places that I've talked to that are the most successful with this are the people who are using an agile approach to their iterative IT organizational changes to continue to improve all the time with or without containers. Again, the tool, while handy, is not necessarily the point. So with that, I wanna say thank you. And I'm not sure if we have time for questions, but I will be around and I appreciate checking with everyone. Thanks. I can take one question. One brave soul who is not hungry enough for lunch and actually wants to talk for a moment. No one ever takes me up on that. This is the right before lunch time slot. Okay, we're done. Thank you so much.